Welcome back to the Hank Strange Situation, Lifestyles of the Locked and Loaded.
Make sure to check out hankstrange.com. You can sign up for our email list and find ways to follow and support our efforts.
So someone here, Yoel Adams, I'm going to try to get some questions to people, but he says, do something like Chris, make a new system of action. Obviously, Chris, he's talking about Chris Vector. So you're saying you wouldn't go in the bullpup direction. What kind of stuff are you guys thinking about? If you could talk about that, like, future direction. Do you think it's just going to be a derivative of basically what's there now?
I still like the stoner design.
Okay.
I still like how it puts together, how it assembles quickly. Mm-hmm. It's kind of, I don't want to give it so easy like it's Legos. Mm-hmm. Maybe having it to where it doesn't need a buffer in the back where you do side folding or stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Or I don't know if side folder's the answer, but I do know this, in any mechanical design, mm-hmm. when you have quick release barrels or whatever you want to do, mm-hmm. if you want a side folder or a collapsible stock or something like that, mm-hmm. all these things we discuss to have something that's repeatable and durable, mm-hmm. and reliable adds weight.
Yeah.
So you could take your barrel off. How much more to the mechanism does it add? So I'll give you an example. Oh, we're in the military. We got to have a quick release barrel. Mm-hmm. We got to be able to go from a 10.5-inch barrel and go to our 24 because I'm going to be a sniper in the hide.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's no problem. You know who did the best design ever?
Who?
Eugene Stoner, those two push.
Okay.
Prove to me how you're going to shoot, because I got a quick change barrel and mm-hmm. I changed from a 10-inch and a 1/2-inch barrel and I put a 24-inch. Mm-hmm. What's my zero? My velocity change, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did it shift? Because I got this barrel coming in and out. Mm-hmm. Did my point of impact change? Mm-hmm. Because the more you take it in and out, things wear.
Yeah. It's so, an interesting concept. I mean, I guess...
We haven't got to the big issue.
Okay.
I'm not doing an entry with a 20-power scope or a 25-power scope. I'm with a dot sight.
Mm-hmm.
So what do I do now? Do I throw my scope on this or do I shoot with my dot sight 860 yards out with 15-mile-an-hour wind east and, you know, Kentucky windage.
Yeah. I think one of the problems there is the thing that we have of trying to make everything into one, right? It's like cars. Sometimes you need a pickup truck, you know, sometimes you need a muscle car. So there's different uses for different things, right?
Yeah. There is.
And sometimes that's the best solution. Put down one gun, pick up another one.
Okay, mm-hmm. It may be. Mm-hmm. Or what, can you have something as a category? Can you do something for an urban environment and own the 600 yards? And then when you're out in the mountains, you want to shoot to a mile, mm-hmm. get to 338. Mm-hmm. So I'll say, okay, I was talking about a bullpup design. Do you know how much pressure's on the bolt on ignition for a 338? It's over 17,000 PSI.
Okay.
If those lugs break, that bolt is going right through your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
It is going to punch right through you.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I don't like bullpup designs, because mm-hmm. what happens there. So anyways, mm-hmm. but when you're talking in two different elements, you're talking an urban element and you're talking a rural out in the mountains, out in the opening. There's two different types, of course. That little 9mm subgun's not going to do good from mountaintop to mountaintop. You right. need something that reaches out and touches someone, mm-hmm. large caliber, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what if you could build one platform in an urban environment that can own 600 yards, even push out to 750 if needed,
mm-hmm.
and you could do CQB with it?
The same gun?
Yeah, what kind of gun would that be?
Same configuration, same barrel, you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because when you want to change everything, it adds weight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What could possibly do that?
I don't know. I'm interested. What can do that?
Wouldn't that be, I wouldn't say the holy grail, but that would be a great application for the urban environment.
Right.
If you make that one. Mm-hmm. Because I've been watching a lot with firearms over the years, mm-hmm. the AR, the MSR type of guns, right? Mm-hmm. America's right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, MP5 is the most famous subgun ever made. Hands down to them. Mm-hmm. I still haven't seen a product that goes 500,000 rounds like them and still run and run and run.
Mm-hmm.
So they've owned that crown for quite some time.
Okay.
It's 9mm. What do I do at a distance, or how does that work with vehicles and stuff like this?
Mm-hmm.
So the 300 Blackout was created, I believe, to handle more of the law enforcement. Number one, like you said, HK, their service isn't the best, and they weren't. They weren't supporting those MP5s. Law enforcement needed an alternative. Hey, you made a 300 Blackout that shoots subsonic ammo really good, a big heavy bullet, performs pretty much the same, but you have a lightweight platform, right? A short barrel lightweight AR.
You can suppress it easy, like you said. Right?
And everyone can manipulate and handle really quick and fast. Mm-hmm. And tell me one platform that's quicker in getting back in the fight than the AR design that Stoner did. Mm-hmm. With all his manipulation of mag releases, bolt releases, and trigger, not even talking about enhancements like the stuff we did with ambidextrous features, mm-hmm. just the standard skill. I own an MP5 full auto, mm-hmm. transferable. I would go to subgun matches, and every time there was someone like an officer that had a Colt 9mm, he would clean my clock. Mm-hmm. You know why? Because as soon as that gun runs out of ammo, you gotta use a hand, take the mag out, get the mag in it, go up, rack it, and mm-hmm. release. You know ARs. You
versus just drop the mag, put another one in, close the bolt.
Go up, and you're mm-hmm. back in the fight in seconds.
Mm-hmm.
Stoner did a really quick thing, and ambidextrous features make it even more fluid if you train on it.
Okay.
So
how do we, like, what I'm trying to get, I mean, I don't know if you're alluding to something that you're coming out with or something that's already out.
It's already out.
Yeah, so.
In the course of building things over the year,
mm-hmm.
in the course of failing at a lot of things,
mm-hmm.
you learn through failure.
Okay.
Especially if you're a process engineer, all data is important. Good data and failed data.
Mm-hmm.
All it's good because it helps you learn and mm-hmm. understand what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, the reality was, how do you make something better? To me,
mm-hmm.
I've watched the industry for easy decade trying to make the AR-15 M16 be more than what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Always coming up with a cartridge to try to be like the battle rifle 7.62x51. We had a 6.8, right?
Mm-hmm.
6.8 SPC. Well, we're about 70% of what the 7.62x51 308 does.
Mm-hmm.
But it fits in the AR. You have a 6.5 Grendel. Hey, I can shoot distances. Hey, Bill Alexander, when you came up with it, you're pushing me to do it, and the only available ammo wouldn't shoot half MOA, but all your hand loads did that no one could buy.
Mm-hmm.
So why do you sell a product until you see recently like Hornady building it where you have good, accurate ammo? The whole problem with that gun was it was plagued, too, with bolt issues. You had 7.62x39 even in ARs, right?
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
The problem with our military from the 60s when we adapted the M16 and even law enforcement, including up to today, we are overmatched by our adversaries.
Mm-hmm.
Period. Ended. They always have a bigger, badder cartridge.
Mm-hmm.
We kick ass as Americans, American patriots. Why? Because of love of nation. There's nothing better and greater than people that volunteer for a love of nation and a love of freedom that overcomes all adversaries, period, ended.
Mm-hmm.
And when we're fighting it with a deficiency because we're overmatched, being that we have smaller cartridges going into a fight, but where we kick ass is what I said earlier, communications and skill set. We kick ass there. But unfortunately, this country goes around and trying to help a bunch of shitbags around the world that turn on us over time.
Mm-hmm.
So they start learning our tactics. They start learning how we communicate. So to me, All I care about is America first. And I want our people to own whatever. So if you can do what all these different cartridges trying to be like with the AR or M16, I mean, look, you got even today a 300 blackout. Well, it shoots a 30 caliber bullet. Okay.
So are we talking about the Rogue here? We're talking about the Rogue?
Is that the Revolution was the start of it. It was a combination of all the years working, and that's what we did. We literally engineered an M16 AR-15 receiver up and lower to shoot 7.62x51. Obviously, we have a 308 magwell. That's what's different on the lower. The upper receiver has a larger trap door, but I could still shoot a smaller AR-15, you know, 223 cartridge out of the larger ejection port, but it doesn't matter. And why would I want to make those guns 5.56 if I'm already shooting 308? It doesn't make sense. I use the same barrel nut, the same gas block, the same rail, the same M16 charging handle, the same bolt carrier, roller cam pin, cotter key. All you do is change the bolt and firing pin.
Okay.
And I make that gun shoot 308. That's why we are lighter than every single gun in the planet when it comes to the 7.62x51. I'm not using unobtainium materials or materials other than full strength stuff. I don't have carbon fiber. I don't have lithium. Right. I don't have magnesium.
You're not using pencil barrels, I don't think, right?
I don't have titanium. So our first walk in the park was the piston-driven Revolution. Came out in 2017. And that was 7.3 pounds for the 16.5. The 12.5 inch barreled gun was 6.7 pounds, 6.75 pounds. You know, 2019, we brought out the DI version with a flat top bubber and without the backbone in it, with a regulator gas block. The 16.5 inch, and we're all talking now so everyone's on the same page. When I'm saying 16.5 inch, it's a 15 inch rail, rifle length gas block position. So I'm making the barrel and as heavy as it can be, and that position is 7.3 pounds for 308 in an AR-15 chassis, period. And this isn't a small frame. This isn't an AR-10. It is literally an M16 AR-15 platform that shoots 308. Great marketing by DPMS 2 years after the fact. All they did was knock off the Colt 901. The 901 came out 2 years earlier at SHOT Show. And they never advertised that they made a smaller receiver set. So the small receiver, like you're saying, short action, long action, the short action or the small receiver, small frame receiver is the M16. The large one is the AR-10. And I'll give you an actual number. The AR-10 is 1.5 inches longer than the M16. That means the carrier, the diameter of the carrier is a lot bigger too and heavier. The Colt 901, the DPMS G2, is 1/2 inch shorter than the AR-10. Where's the M16 AR-15 and now the Revolution and Rogue that Patriot Ordnance Factory engineered is still 1 inch shorter than the Colt 901 or the G2 or anyone that's gone off the
design. I think that's like 6 pounds or something like that, right? Let me see.
Yeah, so the 16.5 inch Revolution with a rifle length gas block is 6.8 pounds. The 12.5 inch pistol with the brace on it, 6.32 pounds. It's lighter than an MP5 with a retractable stock.
Okay, so how are you doing it? How are you doing it?
I just told you. We engineered an AR-15 that shoots 308. It has the same size diameter bolt and barrel extension.
But it can handle the same levels of pressure, stress, all that kind of stuff.
Because we upgraded through destructive testing.
Okay.
You know, I'm talking why I wouldn't do a bullpup design. We do destructive testing. like you should do in engineering.
Right.
And
right.
we found the metal, which I'm not going to say, but
that's the secret sauce.
I consider it a super alloy, and how it performs, okay. it's amazing. Mm-hmm. So I see people on the internet, different manufacturers, where they throw out 9310 bulk being a super alloy. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you something there, correct you. Because it all goes back to when I was building triggers. Mm-hmm. 9310 or S7. S7 is a material. And it's a hammering material. It's really good for punching and stuff. Mm-hmm. The problem with S7 material, it's kind of like the Titanic. That Reliable that was on the market in S7. Mm-hmm. When it first came out, they were having issues when it got real cold, like zero temperature. Because mm-hmm. you do destructive testing and you do a Sharpie test. A Sharpie test, mil-spec specifications from the military is room temperature, and the next test is minus 40 degrees. Hmm. It's got to withstand and hold up. Metals transition. So when the Titanic was built and engineered, it was already the ship of death.
Okay, because they didn't do that kind of testing to see what it would do in those cold waters. Okay.
Yep, when they shipped in the cold waters and hit and breached, they could never stop the leak. That's why it mm-hmm. sank. They couldn't stop the leak because the metal transitioned and it became extremely brittle and it snaps cleanly. So at one time, with the craze in buying because of fear, you know, with our politicians again wanting to take away our ARs at one time because it's an evil rifle. Mm-hmm. It does nothing. It's an inanimate object. Mm-hmm. I have 32 cameras in the factory. Mm-hmm. I have yet to see one firearm
come out of the safe,
load itself, and go out the door for the night on town. And
go
come
postal.
Back. Yeah.
Yeah.
Make sure to check out HankStrange.com. You can sign up for our email list and find ways to follow and support our efforts.